the poor board management of RAR. Firstly, I would like to apologize on behalf of the MEC that he had to go to the NCOP at a short notice. That's why he could not be here. And we tried to arrange other MEC to stand for him, but most of them are out of the province. As you all know, that there's a Women's League conference. All the women MEC are attending Women's League province, conference in Bunari, and other MECs are engaged in Palamba. There's a hotel there, MEC's what is attending to that matter, MEC Fetcher based out of the province. So you will have loved to be part of this session so that you can demonstrate and show that whatever we are doing, we are united in terms of changing the face and the future of this institution, which most people value of this province. I think what I will do is there are certain things that are on the presentation that I will not go through because obviously they were covered by our colleague from CSIR. But firstly, I would like to also acknowledge the presence of our colleagues from the municipalities department. I can recognize Mr. Floyd Brink because I know he's passionate about the roads. So welcome here. And other members from the Public Works Department, which is our sister organization. And I think I need to emphasize the point that I've told the CEO many times that RAL and Public Works work together. There is no competition. And we must move with that understanding. That the roads agency, Limpopo, is an implementing agency of the department. There can never be a competition. The MEC of Public Works, Roads Infrastructure, is the sole shareholder of the roads agency. I think we must move from that understanding. And the decisions, especially relating to the legislative mandate of RAR, rest with the shareholder and the cabinet of the province. And nobody else, not even the board. The presentation will cover our legislative mandate, which talks about the RAL Act, which remains a supreme act that is responsible for our establishment. I must say that that act, all of us, I think if we've gone through it, we know that it's outdated. And it's one of the things that the board will look at to make sure that we make it current. It does not conflict with Companies Act. It does not conflict with PFMA. It's one of the things that we want to be bringing new changes. Also to make sure that it's in line with the country at the moment, which at the moment is not. If you look at the RAL Act in terms of the capacities, in terms of the skills of people who are supposed to be in the board, does not make provision for certain skill set, including, for instance, that you need to have a qualified chartered accountant as one of the members of the board to deal with issue of finance, because one of your biggest matter in terms of your address report is the disclaimer, which has to do with our financial management and asset management. So we're going to be looking in terms of the skill set, in terms of what is it required to make the board of RAR more effective and more relevant. And then we'll make amendments. We'll talk about the governance structure, the committees of the board. They are still also not talking to the mandate of RAR. But since you have a budget, every year you have a strategic session. But when you go back, Mr. Bakuba, the way you design your budget, it must talk to the strategy goals of RAR. A budget is not a discretionary matter of the CEO or yourself or anybody else. It must talk to the strategic goals so that you achieve the goals. If the strategic session decides to say that we must do the new generation, one of the things you must do is to go back and look and say, how are we going to achieve the revenue generation? If you want to establish a plan, you want to draw one of the road, your budget must talk to that. If you want to appoint a transactional advisor to do a business case, it must talk to that. So it cannot remain the same, the budget every year. You must go and look at the chart of accounts. You must have a revenue section, which you don't have at the moment. So this is not an academic exercise. After this thing, your budget must go and talk to what is decided there, ultimately approved by the board. I'll talk about the summary of achievement. Strategic partnership, which is very critical, because one of the things that we come across in the province is the private sector complaining that government is closing doors. People in government are not willing to work with private sector. And private sector is prepared to put money on the table to make sure they supplement whatever little we have in order we can do more for our communities. The issue of road infrastructure, if all of you can check the Limpopo development plan. Ultimately, the NDP, we say that in the NDP that the infrastructure is important in terms of stimulating the economy of the country. Government has planned our infrastructure to stimulate the economy, to create employment. Without that, we cannot. So RAL cannot operate in isolation. We must operate with other government departments and structures of government in order to create job employment. I've said to the CEO that job creation should not be a statistical matter. We want to know that if Mr. Rukhutu, we doing a road in Bavaru, give us a practical number of people who have been employed in that region. We don't want estimate figures that come from the consultants because they want to justify the invoice. So that's what we should be moving in that direction. I think all of you are aware that we established in terms of the Northern Province Road Agency Provincial Act, which I spoke about, that needs to be changed in our electricity company. We are the ultimate authority of the road agency is the board, which I'm saying that in terms of the plans of the board, we'll have to review the board as it's currently composed. The committees of the board is the view of the board that we need to revisit that. In terms of the King 3 now, we're supposed to have a social and ethics committee. We need to have a finance committee to make sure that we don't give all the responsibilities of having a proper budget to the CFO, for instance, so that by the time the budget is approved, it talks to all what has to be achieved by the road agency board. And obviously, we have at all times interact with the department because we must not commit what we don't have. That's the principle that we move on. We must never commit what we don't have because that's the reason why we are in the situation we are today. Road agency Limpopo is responsible on behalf of the department for all roads in the province without exception. And that needs to be understood. The department established road agency Limpopo to be responsible for managing all the roads and maintenance of the province on behalf of the department. And I think that needs to be understood. There can never be a decision different to this one unless the cabinet, through the shareholder, take a different position. I think you'll see that the MEC is responsible and shoulder to appoint the board and exercise political oversight. The issue of political oversight is important because many of us here, including in the board, regard themselves as politicians. But there's only one person responsible for political oversight. That is the MEC of Infrastructure, Public Works, and the General. Other people who are political activists, they must do that outside the agency board. We have the board, which at the moment composed of the audit committee, the REMCO planning and contracts, which I'm saying is going to be restructured after the strategic session. Then we've got the CEO, who's appointed by the board. In turn, he then appoints other executive members, which we also spoke about the structure of RAL talking to the mandate of RAL. At the moment, the structure of RAL does not talk to the mandate of RAL. It's just a structure. So we need to look at the structure and say, can we deliver on what we're tasked to do, given the capacity and the skills we have in the organization? That's one of the things that when you move out here for next year, because obviously you can change it mid-term and say, do we have the correct structure to deliver on our mandate as a whole infrastructure organization? Then we have the company secretary, which is a report administratively to the CEO and functionally to the board. I think the CSIR, Mr. Michael Rose, has spoken about our road networks and the work they are doing around the our asset infrastructure, and we hope through them we'll be able to achieve a proper asset register, a road management asset register, so that the issue of the water general, which account for the bulk of the reason why we have this claim, can be addressed. And we told the CEO in the last board meeting that we'll want to track that progress. If I wish, and whenever there's opportunities, it is important that we give people a chance before we go outside. It is very important, CEO, that we do that. And then where our people are lacking, it's important that we come with programs to assist them. And when people are failing, we need to tell them why are they failing. We should not just assume and ignore them. I think we need to all understand the staff equally. You should be free to raise issues within proper protocol so that we make sure that we move as well. Because without staff, management alone cannot achieve its objectives. It is highly impossible. And I'm also referring to Mr. Kuyang, that at some point you might need to register and do your masters. So our shareholders, our stakeholders, local government, government departments, private sector, money and culture, and other state-owned entities. We have entities like the Great North Transport in the Bob, which is responsible for public passing of people and communities. GNT spend a lot of money on maintenance. It's one of the things we discussed with the CEO. That cost government a lot of money on maintenance. One of the things we will plan in terms of new roads, in terms of maintenance, for instance, of gravity, we need to collaborate with GNT to say our priorities, where must we start? Because if we tar most of the roads that GNT uses, we're saving government money in terms of maintenance. In return, we can make a case to provincial government for asking for more money on maintenance. So this thing must talk together. We have LEADER, for instance, the Limpopo Economic Development Agency, which provide finances, microfinancing to entrepreneurs, contractors. One of the things we must do that our contractors, especially historically disadvantaged, have no access to finance. Some of the people get disqualified because they can't raise guarantees and so on. LEADER is here just around the corner. We need to interact with LEADER, bring them on board so that they can support some of the contractors, give them whatever arrangement is made to make sure we support them as we start with new projects. But there's no way you will develop new contractors if you don't have even finance mechanism. You've been banking with APSA for many, many years. It's time that APSA must give you a viable financial proposition that support not only contractors, but the staff of RAL, for instance. Get better rates, get better vehicle schemes, all those things. CEO, that's one of the things that we need to do to make sure that we empower people. We got to the challenges that we faced when we came to office. One of the first things that is critical is disclaimer, adverse audit opinion. This is very important because there will be no bonuses paid to anybody as long as there's disclaimer. But equally so, we're not going to punish innocent people because of individuals. When we can pin down people who are responsible for disclaimer, we'll isolate them, deal with them separately, and other people can get bonuses. But the principle is no board will get disclaimer unless we get a clean audit opinion. And one central issue around the disclaimer is people refusing to give the audit around documents. And that issue is a serious issue that we need to address as a matter of agency. Because the issues of why we have disclaimer are simply limited to the asset management and the issue of source documents. And that's all. So we need to all of us commit ourselves to make sure that we contribute towards bettering the situation. Because it's not all people or all functions within that that are responsible for disclaimer. And it's not just the responsibility of the CFO to make sure we get a good audit opinion. It's the responsibility all of us contribute towards a better opinion. And I think it's time we must start working towards that direction. The issue of maintenance, we get calls every day. Yesterday there was a strike in Palabura, there was a strike in Kavalastal about what was maintenance. And I told the CEO that it's time that we need to move faster. But among other things that this meeting must achieve is to say how do we respond to emergency situation within the laws of the country. How do we respond when people of Apasha Mampuru want their own immediately? And you've got PFMA, you've got Companies Act that you need to comply with. There's some other things that you need to discuss as you come out and come with proposition to say how do we as an organization respond to make sure that we address those things. But the one reason why we established is to serve our people, nothing else. The issue of insufficient revenue, if all of you have read the PwC report on the status of RAL, when they compared it with SANRAL, was that RAL does not generate revenue. But the end of RAL allows RAL to generate revenue. So what this meeting needs to do is to come with avenues. How can we raise revenue? Among other things, is to look at in terms of R33, which is transferred to SANRAL, but it remains our responsibility because it's a key economic group in the province. Whether if companies like PMC are not coming into board, maybe we might look in terms of say we can do it as RAL and maybe toll the road for business only. Those are some of the things that we need to look at. The issue of advertising and billboards. The money we're receiving from billboards is too small. We need to audit that process and say, how can we raise more money from billboards? We've got a lot of multinationals who use billboards as a form of media advertising. I think these are some of the things that you need to look at and say, how do we raise revenue? This is just one or two examples. You also have the issue of asphalt, coal, and rocks. To say, why can't RAL through public works and public works, obviously with the approval of Treasury, establish a joint venture with private sector and own an asphalt, which they make it exclusive for that entity, which can in turn generate revenue. Those are some of the things that this meeting must take care of, so that the board on its own cannot make decisions, implement them. Everything must come from management. Okay, the other issue is the issue of the state of our bridges. I think the bridges, all of you know what happened in terms of the bridges. Talk to the standards, quality assurance. One of the things that you need to do in that division of Mr. Rogozu, you need to separate quality assurance with people who are doing the work. People cannot check themselves. So we must find a way of restructuring that division. Say that when we appoint people from outside, who's checking them when they do the work? And Mr. Rogozu, you can't do everything. We need to move from that premise. That we need to find people, when we say we appoint them to do the roles, if CSIR has given us standards which are used all over the country, who checks compliance? Somebody must check compliance to make sure that our roles are better roles. You know, we can't be doing one role every year, for instance. It's because of lack of compliance to standards. And then there's issues of limited funding, which this one you will never overcome, but you can do better. One of the things that we need to do, this session needs to do, we have agencies of government that are responsible for infrastructure funding. We have what we call a provincial equity infrastructure fund. When there's shortage, there's proper procedure that needs to be followed to make a case to say, we need more money. But you can't need more money when you're not spending. You know, as we're speaking, you're sitting on 10%. You cannot make a case and say you want it to be good when you're sitting on 10%. But spending as well, it means spending on the correct things. Doesn't mean that we must just spend. We must spend on the correct things, but there is alternative funding so that we can deal with the issue of the backlog in the province, especially for what we term as economic roads. I think we need to make a case to say, how do we deal with the 4,000 kilometers of roads which we regard as economic roads? We've got TPSA, we've got African Development Bank. If you look, if some of you have checked Zambia, for instance, they were able to raise money from TPSA to deal with economic with a global foods. Government of Lesotho, they've done the same thing. The government of KwaZulu-Natal now, they started with that process. I think it's time we do a case and we'll present to Treasury here and get approval from Cabinet and we'll raise money from TBSA or African Development Bank. And TBSA is very much willing to assist us in this regard. There's an issue that is very important of irregular wasteful and fruitless expenditure. This issue of irregular fruitless expenditure, on this one, we leave no stone unturned to rectify it. We will not leave this organization 1 hour 10 minutes, and we're not looking for 7-10. We need to deal with this issue. And the only way to deal with it in terms of national treasury regulations, you must investigate what happened, and then make a case to either the provincial treasury and the board, and we can close on the issue of irregular expenditure. Wasilas on the issue of irregular expenditure will not leave it. That's the message I want to tell from the board. And there's what we term Bermuda Roads. The issue of Bermuda Roads, Mr. Rogozu will know better. The historical concept of what they call the Honor Roads is a process was started some years ago to raise money to deal with backlog. And there was a approval that was given, but it was never followed up. A commitment was made by RAL people, and because commitment was made, contractors then could not conclude those roads. So we should not do the same thing. And when we raise money this time around, before it's approved, and there's an agreement with a lending institution, we should not commit to any contract. The issue around the Muda Road, unlike how people understand it is because of this process of people faithfully trying to deal with the Muda with backlog. But the process was not completed. And that's why we're having 34 Bermuda roads in the province. There's issue of negativity around, there's one CFO in the province who is very good, actually. When we started, we tried to speak to him to say, you can't come to RAL, you know? This guy said, no, you can employ me anywhere else except RAL. I will never come to RAL, even if you can give me a budget of 5 million. So there's negative image about RAL. So what we need to do now, as we do our good work, and good work is good work that can be measured, that can be seen. It needs to be communicated. And then we must make sure that RAL become a place where people will want to work at RAL. And I even say to the CEO, there comes a time when, for instance, we need to collaborate with our higher learning institutions like the University of Limpopo, University of Venda, and University of Stellenbosch to deal with issue of internship, issue of training of our engineers, and other fields like accounting and other areas that are relevant to the infrastructure design. And those are some of the things that you need to discuss to say, how do you interact with higher learning institutions to make sure that there's a pool of people coming to RAL in terms of training. And also our people who graduate from this institution, their first preference in terms of employment is supposed to be the province. It's not supposed to be Johannesburg Road Agency when they just jump in RAL around the corner. Those are the challenges that Mr. Machi, you need to focus. And those are important because they affect and touch the lives of our people. All of you know that we're being under administration. Administration has not gone completely, contrary to what people think. Actually, this week there was a reporting at the National Treasury. We still report to only this time to National Treasury in terms of spending, in terms of how we do things. So it's important that we don't have to be wise to do the correct things. We have to do the correct things because that's what we're supposed to do. I won't go a lot in terms of the achievements, what has been achieved, but one of the key things that was critical when we arrived here was to filling executive positions. We still have other two or three executive positions that needs to be filled. So we have made commitment to say we'll do that in our first year of office, but that has passed, and I think it's important that we fill them now. I hope that we'll do that as a matter of urgency. There's an issue of the organizational structure. We need to get input from staff as well to say what is the correct structure to respond to our mandate. And also make sure that all positions are funded when you create positions. Because we can't create positions in the financial aid team. And we should not be giving people tasks that do not exist in the structure. There's issue of change management. I think that is an ongoing program. There was a decision taken by the board at some point to say we need to do an assessment of our staff, know their strengths and weaknesses, and come with intervention program to assist them so that whenever there's opportunities, they're able to respond themselves. We must not disadvantage them because of historical issues. I think the issue of engineering, I've spoken about it. Internal capacity, I think, is also talks to the issue of bringing engineers within the organization to make sure we're able to check what is done by other people. I mean, the issue of cost of the project is the same thing that talks to an issue of quality assurance. When consultants give you a project cost, how do we know that it's the correct cost? I think those are some of the things that can be addressed by the structure that are correct people to the organization. In procurement, Mr. Abushanyan, you know, is one of our key challenges. We need to do something about procurement. We can't continue procuring using raw methods. There are people outside there who can call you anytime and tell you, no, I've been doing work at RAND for 10 years. Why that you are here now, I can't even get a project. So there's entitlement that has been developed. I think we must stop that and then make sure opportunities are available to other people. And we must produce new entrepreneurs. We can't be recycling people. We need to produce new people. The issue of our veterans of our struggle, the issue for our female contractors, the issue of the disabled, we need to address those things. So we need to generate new entrepreneurs. We can't be recycling the same people. They go up, go down, go up because RAND is there. We can't wait on that. I will not talk about the PMU. I think those are the things that Mr. Kozu in his department will deal with them. The project management, projects being completed on time. There are some projects that, I mean, when I look at the register of RAND, they started a long time ago. And then when you ask how far they are, they're still on, even now, maybe 2006. You can't have a road that is done over 8 years. You know, even if we do a subway in America, doesn't have it. So those things we need to address, the issue of project management, accountability, because otherwise it depends on the budget. And when anyone to respond to what is necessary for people in the province. I will not talk a lot about the issue of achievements. I think all of you know what is happening there at the moment. But I think I spoke about the issue of billboards. I'm not talking about the pictures that you see. I'm talking about the billboards that generate money, not the expenses. All you know that Mr. Machi started on the 1st of March. This mandate is very clear, and it will be emphasized and concluded in this performance contract. One of the things we need a clean audit. That one is non-negotiable. We need to make sure that there is no irregular expenditure. That is non-negotiable. We make sure that the culture of RAND changes, that everybody feels at home and that they can wake up and come to work. I think those are the key things that we need to do to turn around this organization. I spoke about the subcommittees that have to structure them and subcommittees to make sure that we have proper skills to make sure this organization is going in the right direction. I think all of you know about the database, which was central last year in terms of why we got an audit opinion. It's good that this year is not in the findings. The appointment of CSIR. Obviously, people may ask themselves questions, why CSIR? It's not because Machi is from CSIR. CSIR is responsible. It's the system that some people try to service. It comes from CSIR. And CSIR is an organ of state. We took a rational decision to say, if you buy the system from a private company, you're putting the IP of government in a private company. So we rather source it from government so that it remains with government. We don't want any consultant or company to hold us hostage. That's the reason why we encourage making state organs. I think wherever we go, first preference is to work with state organs. In the absence of state organs with capabilities and abilities, we go for private sector. That is the rationale. There's issue of forensic investigation, termination of illegal contracts. We do not have the love for forensic. Nobody loves forensic. But when things don't go right and people don't want to do the right things, we're left with no choice but to engage forensic investigation to correct things. And if all of you check the National Treasury description in terms of dealing with the irregular expenditure, you can never deal with the irregular expenditure in an acceptable manner until you appoint an independent person to check what happened. That's the only way. When we went to SCOPA, specifically the current MEC of Treasury, the chairman of SCOPA said, we'll not listen to you guys unless you tell us what happened to the Bermuda Goods. And Mr. Salman cannot alone investigate this Bermuda Goods. It's not possible. With all his good abilities. And we need to fast track that process so that we can close the chapter. This exercise is not targeting or facing on anyone, it's just compliance with the law. Because otherwise we'll never achieve clean audit. The same applies to illegally terminated consultants. I spoke about it. There are people who believe that RAL was formed for them outside. They are the only one who must work at RAL forever. That must come to an end. Nobody. This must be an open, competitive environment. We must have new consultants. Old one will support them, is fine. But let's generate new people so that we can be proud at the end of our legacy to say, at least we've introduced 10 consultants that we can see our products of RAL. It is a shame that today we cannot even go in a Nancy company that we say is a product of RAL after so many years of establishment. It must be a deliberate intention to create those things. It must not be by accident. We must take a deliberate action to say we want to see female contractors that we can be proud they move from RAL, they are doing work in Mafikeng. We must be proud and say that we produce veterans of our movement, of our struggle, who now are doing business in other areas. We can't keep on supporting the same people and then they keep recycling themselves. And because they've developed friendship with some of us, and then we don't see anything wrong. I spoke about the issue of backlogs, and there's good initiatives around partnership with Anglo-American, Anglo-Platinum, which will also help in terms of issue of generating capital to deal with the issue of backlogs. I know that last week, 2 weeks ago, RAL signed with Exaro, which they committed $71 million. We're still in negotiation with PMC, which will deal with the issue of R40. And then I know that the CEO reached an agreement with Marula Platinum to deal with the issue of G140. And we're talking with Barloworld, precisely because if you look at Barloworld, what they specialize in is the issue for equipment. You give people projects who are small, then they go to the multinationals, who charge them exorbitant amount on equipment. Next thing, when they finish their project, they have nothing to show. So we then decided deliberately to say, let's talk and do a partnership with Barloworld so that our contractors can directly benefit from that. Then there's no third party who will just put their backup in the process. So then people are able to benefit from the transition they get from that. That's the rationale around the issue of Barloworld. All of you know what happened in the issue of Dubazi, Ramampuru Pasha, there was violence there. And then as well, we had to respond because that road that the Premier promised the people of Ramampuru Pasha to say we'll attend to that road, like other roads in the province. But I think we should have a response mechanism as you, as an organization, to do an assessment in terms of areas of concern of our people in the province. You know, we should not wait for protest actions. Then we phone Mr. Rikoso, what's happening to that road? I think we must have a way to say, how do we assess the state of our roads and how do we respond immediately before people embargo process actions? I think the issue of backlogs I've spoken about, we've made a presentation now to MEC, and then we've made a presentation to EXCO of the province to ask for more funding. And we hope it will be granted to deal with some of the workload areas. All of you will realize that there's billboards around the province. One of the reasons why we embark on a PR exercise is to try to change the minds of the people around RAL. And it's not only about RAL, even the department. Actually, we spoke to the acting HOD as well. It was part of the discussion to say public works, for instance. They open schools, they open clinics, but we are silent about that. People assume you're doing nothing if you don't talk about it. You have 19 roads that you need to do maintenance on. If you don't talk about it, people are saying RAL is doing nothing. These people are just paying themselves too high salaries. That's what people are saying outside, because people don't know what they're doing. So it's important that we must communicate our achievement, what we do. And it's important you must be open to criticism. It's not like what we do, all of it is correct, but we must do something so that they can be criticism, so that we can rectify ourselves. And we want to get feedback. in terms of the things that we do, so that we can improve. And even when we leave office, we can leave a legacy and other people to come and take over and improve from what we did. I think I will not talk about the rule of law. All of you know how important it is for us in terms of transportation in the province, connecting one province to the other. I mean, we are recently one of the few provinces where the cabinet nationally allocated us to what we call special economic zones. That talks directly to what RAL does, because it's about infrastructure, industrialization of rural areas. If all of you check the history of China, how China 30 years ago decided to go on special economic zones in terms of developing their rural areas into industrial zones. When people today travel from here to China to go and buy cheap things, it's something that was planned 30 years ago. They decided deliberately to leave the capitals of China and focus on rural areas and create manufacturing companies. That is the whole concept of a special economic zone. I think that's what we need to support our government, because it's important now that as they choose Messina and towards a special economic zone, it is important that the roads going to those areas are proper roads, because otherwise it's going to be difficult to develop industrial areas in those regions. I think I've covered everything, but above all, I want to wish you well, and I hope, I believe that the board at the end of this current financial year will be approving bonuses for you. Thank you very much.